Snowball Earth. What could cause a future global freeze? Approximately 650 million years ago, it is believed that the Earth was completely covered in ice. This phenomenon is known as Snowball Earth. During that period, our planet was completely unrecognizable from what it is today, since there was no place with water in a liquid state. Thanks to volcanoes expelling immense amounts of carbon dioxide over thousands of years, the planet's atmosphere warmed and the ice melted, ending the Snowball Earth. But could this happen again? Could the conditions be presented again to cause a new ice age that completely freezes the planet? In this video, we will find out. What caused the last Snowball Earth? The Snowball Earth hypothesis proposes that during several episodes in Earth's geological past, the planet experienced near total freezing, with the oceans and land surfaces completely covered in ice. Evidence suggests that the most significant event occurred during the cryogenic period, approximately 720 and 635 million years ago. This event profoundly affected the Earth's climate and life evolution, occurring in the Neoproterozoic era, long before the emergence of complex animals. The conditions that led to the Snowball Earth included geological and atmospheric factors. One of the leading causes was the decrease in the concentration of greenhouse gases, particularly carbon dioxide, CO2, which reduced the atmosphere's ability to retain heat. At the same time, the position of the continents contributed to global cooling, as most continental masses were located at low latitudes, which reduced the ability of the oceans to redistribute heat through ocean currents. During this phase, temperatures at the equator could have been as low as minus 50 degrees Celsius, and glaciers extended to the equatorial areas. These temperatures are similar to those in polar regions such as Antarctica or Siberia today. This ice cover altered the planet's albedo, i.e. the amount of sunlight reflected off the Earth's surface. At that time, the sun emitted less radiation than it does today, about 6% less, contributing to the planet's cooling. This, combined with an extremely high albedo, prevented the Earth from absorbing enough solar energy to reverse the freeze. All these factors combined caused the global temperature to decrease and the eventual freezing of all bodies of water. Life on the Snowball Earth was mainly composed of simple microorganisms, such as bacteria and algae. Recent research led by scientists such as Paul F. Hoffman of Harvard University and Daniel Schrag suggests that these organisms survive due to their ability to withstand extreme conditions. Some of these life forms likely survived in shelters where the ice was less dense, such as near underwater hydrothermal vents or under relatively thin ice sheets in the oceans. How did the Snowball Earth end? The end of the Snowball Earth occurred when a series of volcanic phenomena increased the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, which in turn increased the global temperature. Over millions of years, continuous volcanic eruptions released large amounts of CO2. Because the carbon cycle was in a state of low functioning due to the scarcity of open oceans, this CO2 accumulated, increasing the Earth's greenhouse effect. The accumulation of CO2 led to a gradual warming process, which eventually caused small portions of the planet to thaw temporarily. Water absorbs much more heat than ice and reflects less light. Thus, the slow fusion of these regions triggered a positive feedback loop. The more ice melted, the less sunlight was reflected and the warmer the planet became. This process took millions of years, and some studies suggest that total thawing may have taken anywhere from 1 to 10 million years. As CO2 increased, global temperatures rose, melting the polar ice caps extending towards the equator. Glaciers began to retreat, lowering Earth's albedo and allowing the planet to absorb more solar energy. The role of volcanoes was fundamental in this process. Volcanic eruptions emitted greenhouse gases and released ash and aerosols that may have temporarily accelerated cooling. However, in the long term, the greenhouse gases accumulated more significantly. At the same time, the melting ice led to an increase in marine biological activity, as the release of nutrients trapped in the ice promoted the proliferation of algae and photosynthetic bacteria. The Snowball Earth ended about 635 million years ago at the end of the cryogenic period. The planet began to warm and experience a new geological area of a more stable climate, the Ediacaran, during which multicellular life began to evolve. Scientists such as Joseph Kirschfink of the California Institute of Technology have pioneered research into how CO2 contributed to the thawing of the Earth. Paul F. Hoffman has also worked on modeling these events. Would humanity survive on a snowball Earth? If Earth were to become a snowball Earth again, the human race would face unprecedented challenges. With extreme temperatures potentially reaching minus 50 degrees Celsius even at the equator, most of the planet would be unsuitable for life as we know it. Major human settlements would likely be concentrated in regions near geothermal sources, such as Iceland or areas with underground volcanic activity, where heat from underground could provide heat and power to the settlements. For a time, the best possible location would be off Earth, in low-orbit space stations. Even human settlements on the Moon, but with a total dependence on Earth's resources, these settlements could not thrive for long. Eventually, all astronauts would have to return to Earth and settle in the places closest to the equator where the least extreme temperatures would likely be. Underground cities or highly insulated structures would be essential for survival and the only place humanity could survive for extended periods. Conventional agriculture would be impossible, so humanity would rely on hydroponic crops, advanced biotechnology, and alternative food sources such as protein production in laboratories. Renewable energy, particularly geothermal, would be essential for generating electricity and heating, as would nuclear power. However, all these options would only buy us more time, but humanity could only survive by warming the planet. Contrary to current reality, to reverse the snowball Earth state, the human race would have to drastically increase carbon dioxide, CO2 levels in the atmosphere to restore the greenhouse effect. This could be achieved by burning massive amounts of coal or releasing vast amounts of methane into the air to increase the temperature. In a way, it would be relatively easy for humanity to warm the planet again. Unfortunately, at present, what the planet needs is the opposite. Could it happen again? Although the snowball Earth is a unique phenomenon in Earth's geological history, whether it could happen again is relevant to long-term climate change and cycles. To assess this possibility, current conditions must be compared with past ones. Today, the Earth is in an interglacial period with global average temperatures of about 15 degrees Celsius and atmospheric CO2 levels close to 420 parts per million PPM, well above CO2 levels during glaciations and the snowball Earth periods. By comparison, the Earth currently receives about 6% more solar radiation than it did during the Neoproterozoic, making it less likely that Earth will enter a state of global freezing. The Milankovitch cycles, which describe variations in Earth's orbit and axis that influence climate, predict that Earth will eventually enter another glacial period in the coming millennia. However, the effects of climate change caused by human activity have altered these natural cycles, delaying the global cooling that would be naturally expected. For the Earth to completely freeze again, a drastic decrease in greenhouse gas concentrations and weakening its ability to retain heat would be required. It should also be noted that the reduction in carbon dioxide, CO2, during the snowball Earth events was due to a combination of geological and biological factors that are not present on Earth today. For example, 1. Increased chemical weathering of rocks. During the period leading up to global freezing, the arrangement of continents at equatorial latitudes favored chemical weathering. This process occurs when rocks on the Earth's surface react with CO2 present in the atmosphere, dissolving it in rainwater. This water, loaded with CO2, erodes rocks, especially silicate formations, and weathering products, carbonates and silicates, are transported to the oceans, where CO2 is fixed in the form of carbonates, CaCO3, in marine sediments. This mechanism effectively removes carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and deposits it on the seabed. This process still exists on the planet, but cannot remove the immense amount of CO2 currently in the atmosphere due to human activity. 2. Decrease in volcanic activity in previous periods. At certain times, global volcanic activity may decrease, Since volcanoes are a significant source of CO2, a reduction in the frequency or intensity of volcanic eruptions contributes to less CO2 released into the atmosphere. It is estimated that during the period leading up to Snowball Earth, volcanic activity was drastically reduced, influencing the decrease in greenhouse gases. 3. Negative climate feedback. As the Earth began to cool and glaciers advanced, the albedo increased. This negative feedback cooled the planet even more, freezing more land and sea areas. As the oceans became covered in ice, their ability to exchange gases with the atmosphere was reduced. This isolation of the ocean under the ice reduced the ocean's ability to release CO2 into the atmosphere, contributing to the continued decline in carbon dioxide levels. These combined processes gradually reduced CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere, weakening the greenhouse effect and allowing the Earth to cool enough to trigger a global freezing era. However, none of these processes are currently present on the planet in the same proportion as during the Snowball Earth. Researchers such as James Hansen and Gavin Schmidt of NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies have contributed to the understanding of how current CO2 concentrations and human-induced global warming make a Snowball Earth highly unlikely shortly, as current global warming is a process that pushes the planet in the opposite direction. Although glacial periods are part of natural cycles, the chance of the Earth completely freezing again in the next few hundred thousand years is meager. For a new Snowball Earth episode to occur, a massive change in atmospheric and solar conditions would be needed, which is unlikely given the current climate evolution. Was there really a Snowball Earth? Despite the paleoclimatic evidence supporting the Snowball Earth hypothesis, the scientific community is divided about whether the Earth froze completely or whether a thin band of liquid water existed in the equatorial regions, giving rise to the Sleet Earth hypothesis. This hypothesis suggests that while large parts of the planet were covered in ice, it is possible that some areas near the equator remained partially ice-free, allowing the hydrological cycle and marine life to exist in a limited way. One of the arguments against the Snowball Earth is the difficulty in explaining how the planet could have thawed efficiently after it had frozen completely. If the entire planet's surface were covered in ice, the high reflectivity of the albedo, the low temperatures, and the negative feedback loop would have kept the Earth permanently frozen, even with elevated concentrations of CO2. This is because even if volcanic activity increased, the CO2 produced would freeze immediately after being expelled by volcanoes, which would not increase the greenhouse effect and therefore the global temperature. This is one reason why some scientists such as Richard Peltier of the University of Toronto suggest that it is more likely that the Earth has gone through a state of sleet, where small portions of the ocean were exposed to the air and allowed the carbon cycle and other climate processes to continue to function. Studies suggesting the presence of marine glaciers that did not extend to the equator and the possible existence of seasonal cycles in equatorial regions support the possibility that the Earth was not completely frozen. Other scientists such as Alan J. Kaufman of the University of Maryland have investigated isotopic records that suggest the presence of liquid water at the equator, supporting the Sleet Earth hypothesis. Although there is no definitive consensus, the Snowball Earth remains one of the most fascinating theories in paleoclimatology, and current research continues to search for evidence that solves this mystery about our planet's remote past. The Snowball Earth hypothesis shows us how the planet has undergone extreme transformations, with drastic climate changes affecting geology and life. Understanding these events helps us contextualize current climate challenges and reflect on the delicate balance that keeps Earth habitable. If such a powerful natural cycle can cool the planet completely, what implications would the accelerating human influence on the climate today have? Will we be able to understand and mitigate our actions before facing equally extreme consequences? Let us know what you think in the comments.